So today's chapter is chapter 14, constant allele frequencies. If you remember, allele frequencies means the rate at which those particular alleles, we have two of each, they occur. So the way constant or variant alleles, they have a very important influence on our heredity transmission. So just a recap of some terms before we go into details. What is population? Population means a group of individuals who can interbreed amongst themselves, and they live at a particular time at a particular area. So in a definite geographical area where they can interbreed. Gene pool means sum total of all the alleles, all the genes of all the individuals in a population. Okay, that would be the gene pool. Population genetics, this is what we've been or we will be doing in the next lecture also. It is the study of genetics of the entire population. And gene flow means movement of alleles between populations. Whenever individuals migrate from one population to another, they are taking some alleles with them, combination of alleles. So that is gene flow. They are causing gene flow. Some important parameters here: allele frequency, genotype frequency, phenotype frequency. Phenotype means, of course, you can see the trait. So if you see in a class of 10 students, if 7 have dark eyes, so that is the phenotype frequency. 7 out of 10 students have dark eyes. Genotype frequency, now the dark eyes, is it the dominant or recessive, caused by dominant or recessive mutation, wild type? Is it heterozygous dark eye or homozygous dark eye? So we have to differentiate between them, and that will give us the genotype frequency. While allele frequency is, if we oversimplify the case and let's just assume that there are two alleles for eye color, capital B and small b, and then we have to know what is the frequency of the capital B, at what rate is it occurring in the population, and what rate is the small b occurring. So how do we calculate allele frequencies? We simply count the number of that particular allele, let's say small b, in that population, and then we divide it with the total number of alleles in the population. That means the total number of capital B and the total number of small b, all of this. So this ratio gives us our allele frequency. And usually allele frequency and genotype frequencies play a very important role in population genetics, because populations evolve, or populations have been formed. That means evolution occurs because of change in allele frequency. So this change in allele frequency is the basic change that causes population. For example, the entire, you might have written a big paragraph or an essay in English on something, but what could cause, smallest level change could be a change in the alphabets, which is changing the spelling of a word, that is changing the meaning of the word, and a single change in that word could change the meaning of the entire sentence, and so on, right? So similarly, those changes in allele frequencies cause evolution. So to be able to see if evolution is occurring, this is very difficult. How do we see evolution? Evolution occurs over thousands of years, millions of years. It's not possible for any scientist to see evolution occurring directly in front of them. So actually, scientists study evolution indirectly. They think of a hypothetical situation which would be present if evolution was not occurring. So it is this indirect way of studying something. So then once we see that ideally this is what should have kept on occurring if there was no evolution, but then you see a departure from that hypothetical situation, that departure from theoretically what should be present. So that tells you indirectly that evolution is occurring, because under the conditions that evolution was not occurring, this is how it should have gone. So there are two types of evolution, micro and macro. Micro means small. So these are small genetic changes which occur due to changes in allele frequencies. Okay, people move in, move out, migration, immigration, emigration. These are causing allele changes, and these lead to micro evolution, small steps, baby steps. And then once a lot of baby steps have accumulated, a lot of micro evolution has accumulated, then you see that a new species forms. Okay, so when a new species has formed, that is a macro evolution. Okay, so combination of a lot of enough or sufficient, there's a particular threshold value. When there's a lot of micro evolutionary changes, they all combine together to cause macro evolution or formation of new species. And the two pioneers in the field of population genetics, or in the field of evolution are these two scientists. One is an English mathematician, his name is Hardy, and the other one is a German physician named Weinberg, okay? And these two, because it was so difficult to study evolution, theoretically some things could be hypothesized, but how do you, provide evidence of evolution? So that is why these two scientists, they were not working together, they were working on their own, but they came up with the exact same conclusions almost around the same time. So that is why we call whatever they came up with mathematical proof. So their equation or their law is known as Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium, okay? So Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium is an equilibrium, means a state of balance. This is defined as when there is no evolution occurring. So this is a stage of genetic equilibrium. It's like this ideal world where nothing is changing. So equilibrium, but what kind of equilibrium? Genetic. No gene change is occurring, no mutation is occurring, nothing is changing. Everything is just going on as it has been always. So that is genetic equilibrium, and that is that has been defined by Hardy and Weinberg as their mathematical equation. It's called Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. So they used algebra, they used a lot of, high-level mathematics to explain this particular equation, this particular stage in which, and this was mainly in case of sexually reproducing species, it has to be like human beings, they are diploid. So they stated that if allele and genotypic frequencies do not change, okay, from one generation to the next, then that particular gene is in a state of equilibrium. So if you see, from generation one to generation two, the allele frequencies and the genotype frequencies did not change at all, not even one, a single change. And that particular gene is in perfect balance, is in perfect equilibrium. There has been no evolution in that gene. But if you see any change occurring in the allele or the genotypic frequencies, that means evolution is occurring. So there were assumptions of Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium law, okay? So there are five assumptions, and those five assumptions are, for Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium to exist, these five assumptions have to be met. That means if these five assumptions are met by a population, there is no evolution occurring in that population at that particular time. So that means Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium is exactly opposite to evolution occurring, right? So if one is occurring, the other cannot occur. So what are those five assumptions, five requirements for Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium or for a population to not be undergoing evolution? The first one is the population is infinitely large. Okay, there are, you cannot count. It's so, such a large population. It's just infinite population size. The second assumption is there is absolutely no allele flow. Nobody's going anywhere. Everybody is just wherever they were, they're staying there. Okay, so that is, there is no allele flow. Third is there is no mutation, no spontaneous mutation. DNA is, replicating, error-free, or even if there were error, DNA repair mechanism is functioning perfectly, no errors at all, no mutation. There is absolute random mating. Nobody makes a choice of who they are getting married to. So it is absolute random mating. And fifth is there is no natural selection, no nature acting on which genotype to choose, which genotype has an advantage or higher adaptability. So these are five assumptions. If these five assumptions are met by a population, then that population at that particular time is in Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium, and that population is not evolving. However, even if a single one of these is not met by a population, that means the population is evolving. So in other words, if no mechanisms of evolution are acting upon that population, okay, then evolution will not occur, because there's nothing, there's no mutation going on, there's no natural selection going on. The allele frequencies will just remain constant generations after generations after generation. But it is very highly unlikely. This is impossible. So that all these five assumptions or these five conditions will hold true in real world, and that is why evolution is the inevitable result. Now, a little bit of math, we are not going into the details, okay? This is a very basic elementary genetics class. So you need to memorize something. We are not going into the mathematical derivation of Hardy-Weinberg equation. According to Hardy-Weinberg, They use these alphabets, these letters P. Small p means allele frequency of one allele. We usually take that as the dominant one. And Q is the allele frequency of the second allele, usually recessive. So in a population which has two alleles for every gene, that means P and Q for every gene. So P and Q will total for that particular gene has to be 100%. That means, let's say 40% of the people have this particular allele, then other 60% will have this allele. So P plus Q has to be 100%. That is P plus Q equals 1. That means all of the allele frequencies together is always 1. That means when you know P plus Q equals 1, now if in a mathematical problem you are given that P is equal to, let's say, 0.8, find out the value for Q. It's very easy. You already know P plus Q equals 1. So that means Q would be 1 minus P. So if P is 0.8, so 1 minus 0.8, it would be 0.2. This is for allele frequencies. Then they derive the equation for genotypic frequencies. And this is P square plus 2PQ plus Q square equals 1. Okay, these are genotypic frequencies. What is P square and Q square? P square is the genotypic frequency of the wild type homozygote, because P is the wild type or dominant allele. Q square would be the genotypic frequency for the recessive homozygote, whereas 2PQ is the frequency for the heterozygote. So you see P square plus 2PQ plus Q square equals 1. Now, if you remember this equation and this equation, and what do these terms mean, you can easily calculate if you are just given the value of Q or how many among that population are recessive homozygotes, you can use first this equation to calculate P. And once you know the value of P and Q, that means you know the allele frequencies, then it really doesn't take long for you to calculate the genotypic frequencies. What would be the genotypic frequency of the wild type? You simply do P square, that is homozygous wild type. What is the genotypic frequency for the homozygous recessive? Q square, and you can find it out. So you simply have to first find out what are the values of P and Q. So now this is a little bit, these slides are explaining why this P square and Q square are coming, and it takes you to the basic level of sexually reproducing organisms. So let's say to get a homozygous dominant type, capital A, capital A, what do you need? You need an egg with an allele capital A and a sperm with an allele capital A. So if the frequency, if the probability of this is P and the probability of the sperm with this is also P, what is the probability of getting this? You use product rule, P times P, so it becomes P square. So similarly, this explains how you get the Q square and how you get the heterozygous. If you read these slides, it takes some time to go over these each sentence and it starts making sense to you. Now, we use these problems, we use this information to see how the allele frequency, is it changing or not changing in a population. Now in Hardy-Weinberg, according to Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium, the frequencies should remain the same. So let's say we have taken a trait, the trait is for a short middle finger. So dominant trait is normal length of the middle finger, okay? And P is the frequency of capital D, which is 0.7. Q is the frequency of small d, which is the recessive trait, 0.3. Normal fingers could be a homozygous wild type, a heterozygous wild type, while short middle finger has to be the homozygous recessive type. So you see here P square equals, so we take the value of P and you square it, it's 0.49, 2PQ is 0.42 and Q square is 0.09. This is in generation one, this is the genotypic frequencies we have calculated because we were given the allele frequency. Now, according to Hardy-Weinberg's equilibrium, it has to be completely random mating, right? No choice whatsoever. So when population, if they mate at random, what are the different combinations? And we are using a Punnett square here. These could be the male gametes. They could either have this or this. This could be the female gametes. And then we see the genotypic frequencies in generation two. You see the generation two genotypic frequencies, again, it's the same as this one. in generation one. The genotypic frequencies have remained same in generation two after generation one. This is how populations can be in Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium, okay? And this is because we assumed that the population was perfectly randomly mating, no selection. Now, applying the Hardy-Weinberg equation, for autosomal recessive diseases, the homozygous class is always used to determine the frequency of alleles in a population. For example, this is an example given here. For example, cystic fibrosis, which is an autosomal recessive disease, and we are calculating the frequency of the carriers in this particular population. Now, it has been given that the incidence of cystic fibrosis, okay, that is autosomal recessive, is 1 in 2,000 among Caucasian. That means 1 out of 2,000 individuals can have this. So this is 0.1 by 2,000 means 0.0005. So this is your Q value, because this is autosomal recessive. Recessive means for this individual to have cystic fibrosis, the genotype has to be Q square. Okay, if any single capital Q is present, the person cannot have cystic fibrosis. So we are now we got the Q square, which is the genotypic frequency, and then after we got Q square, we find out what is Q, what is allele frequency. So square root of this is 0.022. So now we have the value of Q. Once we have the value of Q, now we can calculate anything. Now we calculate the value of V by subtracting the Q from 1, which is this. And now the question is asking us to calculate the carrier frequency. The carrier would be a heterozygote person. That means we want to find out 2PQ. So we calculate that, and this is 0.043. That means 1 in 23 individuals has the probability of being a carrier for cystic fibrosis in Caucasian population if this is the incidence. Okay, so this is how we calculate. Or what is the probability that two unrelated Caucasians in the previous population that you just calculated will have an affected child? Now, we just calculated that probability that any single individual is a carrier is 1 by 23rd. So for mom to be carrier is 1 by 23rd. For dad to be carrier is 1 by 23. Then we multiply this 1 divided by 529. Now, a probability that their child has both of those, you know, recessive alleles is 1/4. Okay, out of every four kids, you know, four children they have, was only 1/4. So the probability that two unrelated Caucasians will have an affected child is 1 by 529 multiplied by this 1/4 is 1 divided by 2.116. This is the probability. Now, these are all autosomal traits. What about X-linked traits? Okay, whenever it's sex-linked traits or X-linked traits, it becomes a little bit different because of the XX and the XY chromosome. For females, the standard Hardy-Weinberg equation just applies. It's fine. You do P square plus 2PQ plus Q squared equals 1. However, in case of males, it's a little bit different because males will have only one X. So the allele frequency is the same as the phenotypic frequency. P plus Q equals 1. You don't have to apply this particular equation. For example, hemophilia A. Remember, this is the blood clotting disorder. It's an X-linked trait. So incidence is 1 out of every 10,000 male births. So this is your incidence. So if this is the incidence, and this is in, we're talking about males, so we don't have to apply that P square plus 2PQ in order to get the Q, because now we know straight away this is the Q, because Q square and Q are the same for X-linked diseases in male. So now we find out what is P, and you got P. Now what would be the carrier frequency, which are females, always females, okay? Males cannot be carriers for hemophilia. So 2PQ, find it out about this one. So what is the percentage of affected females? For a female to be affected, it would require 2 doses of that gene. So it's Q squared, it is 1 in 100 million. Okay, so we've calculated from the incidence of hemophilia in males, we've calculated what is the probability that a female would also be affected, plus what is the frequency of the female carriers of this disease. Now, DNA repeats. Usually, and we've talked about this in previous lectures also, there are segments, for example, remember near the telomeres, okay? So whenever it's heterochromatin, you see those DNA repeats, there are repeated segments. And these repeat numbers sometimes can be considered alleles, okay? And they're not considered, they're considered, they're not really alleles. And then they are used to classify individuals. So what are the different types of repeats that we usually consider? These are VNTRs, variable number of tandem repeats, and short tandem repeats. These kind of DNA repeat segments are used in forensics, used in a lot of medical sciences, in clinical sciences, especially in this technique called DNA profiling or fingerprinting, right? This technique was developed in the 1980s by a British geneticist, and he actually, this technique was based on the differences in repeat copy number. Okay, so you take chromosomes from, let's say, whatever evidence was found at the site of a crime, and then you take DNA from a suspect, and then you match them for these repeat segments. So these repeat segments are acting like markers, they're acting like flags. Like if this, the DNA from the location has five of these markers or five of these flags, does it match with the DNA from the suspect? And basically it is calculating the probability that certain combinations, that means combination of the repeats, can occur in two sources of DNA by chance. Of course, it's all probability. So there's always the probability of what are the chances that this DNA from the murder site matches with the DNA from the suspect. So this kind of DNA evidence is actually more used in excluding a suspect rather than convicting the suspect of a crime. So this is how DNA profiles are compared. This is a very common technique used in molecular biology. We do gel electrophoresis, these bands that you see. Okay, these can be DNA gels, these could be protein gels. This technique was used to demonstrate, if you remember Dolly the clone, the sheep, the clone that was made, it was truly a clone of the 6-year-old, you know, ancestral sheep from which the nucleus had been taken from, nucleus had been extracted. So if you see this lane, every vertical line is a lane. The lane with which is written as D, this is DNA from Dolly, the sheep clone. And then just these lanes before D are U and C. These are all of her source, you know, DNA and other cytoplasm material, okay? The fresh donor udder tissue and the cultured donor udder tissue. If you look at the pattern of the bands in these three lanes, you see how strong, you know, strongly they resemble each other in their banding pattern. If you compare it with the other 12 lanes, which are other 12 sheep, so the lab technician who carries out this method is blind to the status of the samples. Okay, when we do genetic analysis or analysis like these in the lab, we are also blind so that we don't get prejudiced. We are blind to the source of the DNA. We do this and then we compare and then we make, okay, these three look similar. So these are from the same source. And then another person who knows what is what will you know, write the conclusions. Yes, lane number U, C, and D, they had the same DNA. That means they are from the same source. And this is what proved that, yes, indeed, Dolly was cloned from these cells, from these donors. So DNA profiling technique, this is a very simplified, list of how this DNA profiling is done. Usually blood sample is collected from a suspect, whoever is, you know, has been held by the police. You take a little bit of blood from this person, you isolate white blood cells because red blood cells don't have DNA. And then once you have the DNA with you, you use certain enzymes that cut the DNA into manageable sizes, okay? And then these DNA segments that have been cut, we use a technique called electrophoresis, and these, you know, DNA is run under the influence of electricity, and DNA being negatively charged will move from towards the positive terminal, towards the anode. So then these fragments, they get aligned by size, okay? So this is what you were seeing here. This is simply DNA fragments. They start migrating from negative to positively charged electrodes, and they get arranged by their size, how heavy they are. And then once the DNA fragments have been separated according to their weight, then that particular pattern is transferred on to a nylon sheet. And then the nylon sheet is tagged by radioactive probes. And then these radioactive probes can be detected by X-rays. And that's what, this is a very indirect technique, but actually it lets you see this is the DNA, and then you can identify or match the DNA profiles. So again, you see here, this was a victim. This is a suspect from a rape case. So some samples are taken from the victim's clothing or body, and then the suspect sample is taken and DNA analysis is done. You see chromosome, the DNA is cut into small pieces, and then that electrophoresis will be done. DNA can be obtained from any cell that has a nucleus. You cannot take a cell that does not have a nucleus. In case that the DNA is extremely damaged, let's say in case of a natural calamity, we are trying to identify individuals or remains of a dead person, and the body has degraded for a long time underwater, or any other condition, or DNA has degraded, then in those cases, mitochondrial DNA might be used. And the FBI has developed a particular system, it's called CODIS, Combined DNA Index System, which uses 13 short tandem repeats. When fingerprinting was originally identified or originally created, it used the VNTRs, it used this. These are longer repeats. Nowadays, it has been modified and it uses these short tandem repeats, STRs. So these are simply, these act like alleles, or they are considered as equivalent to alleles, and then that is how they are matched. So this is the CODIS system. You see, for every chromosome, chromosome 1 through chromosome 22, and then X and Y, they have these particular segmented areas which act as flags, okay? So probability that any two individuals in this world have the exact same 13 markers is 1 in 250 trillion. So that is why when it matches with the CODIS, it is very highly unlikely, as I said, you see 1 in 250 trillion, that they take a DNA from a suspect and they see that all these 13 flags or markers are matching with the DNA from the suspect. So they can be pretty sure that this is the suspect who, the suspect is actually guilty of committing the crime. Now, population statistics is also used to interpret DNA profiles. For example, if you see this case here, this is the hypothetical situation. A man was found brutally murdered, and there were some evidence of skin and blood beneath the fingernails. So the detectives, they took that skin and blood, because that possibly came from the suspect. And these bits of skin and blood were sent to the forensics lab. And the lab techs, the geneticists, they formed the patterns of 5 DNA sequences, okay? So this is the skin evidence. This is the blood evidence. This is from the victim, because they also have to make sure that this is not the victim's own blood or cells. So you see here, this is the victim's staining pattern, banding pattern. And this is what was found in the samples under this person's nails. Now they have a suspect in mind, and they collect some sample from the suspect, and the same analysis is carried out with the suspect's blood as well. Now you look at the banding pattern and you see the similarity in the banding pattern between that of the suspect and the specimen or the sample that was found in the victim's nail. So visually, the detectives are pretty sure that the suspect indeed committed the crime, but they have to be double sure. So now they use Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium, because they have to use that, okay? Although it is very, almost, they're like 90% sure that this suspect is actually guilty. So then they would use the Hardy-Weinberg equation. How do you see, when you see these two bands here very close, they represent that this person is heterozygous for that particular allele. So there you see two peaks. So that's why allele 1 and allele 2 for this gene. Allele 1 and allele 2 for this gene, allele 1. There's only one band here. So this person is homozygous for this. So this one. Now they use these, and they use values allele frequency values for this particular suspect's ethnic group. Okay. Every ethnicity has distinct allele frequencies for genes, and it is already known. Most of these are known. So they use data from Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium, calculate from the allele frequencies, they calculate the genotype frequencies. You see here 2PQ because this is a heterozygous. This is a homozygous. And then they match. What is the probability that this could still be an error? What is the probability that this person is indeed the suspect? So the conclusion was, after they find out all the genotypic frequencies, they multiply all of these frequencies. And the answer is 1 in 3,226. So the conclusion was that there is a 1 in 3,226 chance that another person in the suspect's population has the same pattern of these alleles, okay? So depending on the chance, then the judge will rule out, okay, how strong is your genetic analysis or DNA analysis. So going by this and with this, the judge will probably say, oh, I see a very strong chance that this man committed the crime. Now, DNA profiling is not just for forensics. It is also used to identify victims. Whenever there are large scale disasters and there is no other way, burned, you know, victims of tsunami, flood and all, where the body has degraded, the face is not recognizable at, you know, anymore. So for example, the World Trade Center attack, the Indian Ocean tsunami in 2004, Hurricane Katrina, 2005, mass scale loss of life, so many victims, and you have to identify. So then you have to go into DNA profiling. But there are a lot of challenges to DNA profiling. It's not very easy. First of all, whenever there's a natural disaster, then it's very difficult. You know, accessibility becomes a huge problem. By the time experts reach those bodies or the, you know, the remains of the person, climate has caused a lot of decay there. It has degraded. There are no laboratories nearby, because the laboratories have also been affected by the natural disaster. So the specimens have to be shipped to someplace far off that would take even longer. Casualties are so many, okay? Not possible to process all of those samples very fast. The DNA that could can be extracted under those conditions could be very poor quality. It could give you a lot of errors there. So all of these could really interfere with the DNA profiling. Also, DNA profiling raises the issues of genetic privacy, because once you have done the genetic profiling, that could be used against a person also. So because you can now identify an individual, it's almost like, you know, how we guard our social security numbers and all these are our private identification numbers. Similarly, our DNA profiles are our individual identity. So maybe in future, sometimes, you know, as hospitals get into more personalized medicine and people's genetic profiles are more accessible, then people have to really guard against keeping this very safe, because genetic profiles can also be stolen. There would be identity theft. Now here I have given you or shared with you two examples of how to solve problems involving Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. Okay. So let's see, a question here is, the albino color in rabbits is caused by a recessive allele small a. That means capital A, small a, and capital A individuals, they are not albino, they are normally pigmented. And only these AA individuals are albino because this is recessive mutation. Now imagine a population with 9,999 normally pigmented rabbits. That means these are not albino, while a single albino rabbit. Okay, now you have to find out all those allele frequencies and genotype frequencies. How would you find out? First of all, what is the total number of the population? 9,999 plus 1, so 10,000. And we always start with the recessive homozygous. So what is the frequency of the recessive phenotype? How many are albino rabbits? Only one. So it is 1 in 10,000. That means this. That means this is the albino rabbit that has the genotype of this small a, small a. So that means what is the frequency of the a, small a genotype? It is 1 in 10,000, exact same. That means we got Q square here, the genotype frequency of the homozygous recessive. So under Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium, Q square is this. Therefore, Q would be square root of this. So we found Q. Once we have Q, we find out P. So P is this. Now we have both P and Q. If you're asked to calculate what is the frequency of the heterozygotes or capital A, small a, you know 2PQ. If you're asked to calculate what is the frequency of the homozygous wild type, you know it's C square. So you will simply do, you simply square this. So this is how you solve problems involving Hardy-Weinberg. Another problem here, example, the percentage of homozygous recessive genotype small a is 36% in a population. Calculate the following. Now, frequency of small a genotype, we just learned that this is 36%. 36% means 0.36. So then what is the frequency of the small a allele? So we got q square here is 0.36. Therefore, q becomes square root of 0.36, which is 0.6. Once we have q, now it's easy to find out p, which is frequency of capital A allele, which is 0.4. Now we have both p and q. Now if somebody asks you to calculate frequency of this capital A means p square. What is the frequency of capital A small a is 2pq. This one. Now this is a little bit added question. What are the frequencies of two possible phenotypes if capital A is completely dominant over small a? So frequency of the recessive phenotype would be 36%, which is already given. Frequency of the dominant phenotype means just externally, it would look, would be, you have to add this and this. So this is 64%. So this is how you can solve a question where only one frequency or one percentage proportion is given to you. You will simply use Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium to calculate this, and we are done. Any questions for me?
For the quiz on Wednesday, is that on chapters 1 to 16, or is it on is it on the chapters after the midterm only?
I think it is given in the study guides. We can always check. Let me check with that. Let's see here, quiz 2. Yes, it is mainly focusing on what you learned after the midterm.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Anything else? So you have discussion session today, and you can practice some problems in population genetics, Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium with UVAE. Also remember, whenever you have some time, please complete that evaluation questionnaire. So I'll see you tomorrow.